Well, today we finish up the 30 days of Awaken Nashville, 30 days of fasting and prayer. And it's been an amazing, amazing month. I mean, just think about it. There have been 550 churches across the metro area that have come together to fast and pray for the city. If you've been around church at any time in your life, you know that is extremely rare. That doesn't just happen. Growing up, it was hard to get the Baptists and the Methodists to sit on the same side of the Golden Corral after church. I mean, it's just hard to get two churches to come together to do anything, much less 550 churches. There's never been anything that I've heard of in the United States like what we're experiencing in our city right now. So you need to know. This is extremely, extremely rare. I was heard from a pastor from Brazil that said, he said, when churches get together like that and pray for revival, it doesn't mean that revival is coming. It means that revival is already here. That there's already the first wave of God reviving his city, of turning a city toward him. So it's happening among us, and it's significant. It's a significant. Can you feel it? I mean, can you sense it in your own heart? Can you sense it in your own life? Do you have eyes to see? Can you see what God is doing? And whenever there's a move of God, there's a choice we have to make. Am I in or am I out? Whenever God begins to move in our lives, we have a choice to make. Making choices is one of the spiritual things we do in life. And we have a choice to make. Is am I in or am I out? And it's not just in movements, it's also in moments. I mean, there are moments in life where we have to make a choice, like, am I in or am I out? I think back to when Awaken started. We started with two services at the Ryman, with two prayer gatherings at the Ryman, a 4 o'clock and a 7 o'clock, and the 4 o'clock was great. I was like, I don't know how we get any better than that, but then I found out at the 7 o'clock. Because at the 7 o'clock, there was this moment we were singing, and we were singing that song, Good Grace, that we just sang, and as we sang that song, I mean, I'm up on stage, and I'm watching what's going on. In this moment, like, something just shifts in the room, and I'm going, what's going on? And then I realize that there are a lot of students that are running down to the front at the Ryman. They're running down to the front, and they're jumping around, and they're dancing, and they're singing. It's like a mosh pit for Jesus, and it's going on. I'm watching these students, and I find that they're refugee students, refugee kids from Rwanda, and they're coming down, and they're just dancing, and they're yelling, and they're, I mean, it was incredible, and I'm watching what's going on. I'm like, I don't want to miss this. I mean, I don't want to be a spectator. Like, I want to get in that. And so I'm up on stage, and I'm like, I know what this is going to mean. This means I'm going to have to get down off stage. But I'm like, I'm not going to miss this moment. So it was a moment where I had to make a choice. Am I in or am I out? And I'm like, I'm not missing this moment. So I jumped down off the stage, not even thinking, how do I get back up on the stage? I didn't even think about that. But get down off the stage, and we were dancing, and we were singing, and we were shouting, and we were praising God with that song. And I'm going to tell you, it was my favorite moment of the night. But I had a choice to make. Am I in or am I out? And think about this, anything significant we experience in life, any great moment or with a great movement, it goes back to that moment of decision, and indecision is a decision. It goes back to that moment where we make a choice, am I in or am I out? And I believe that what God is doing in the city and what he's doing in the lives of people, what he's doing in our church, we have to make a choice. We make choices. When we sense that nudge, we make a choice, am I in or am I out? There were 121 people who were baptized last week. And I just love that moment because even a lot of those people, they didn't make plans to be baptized. It was just in that moment they sensed God saying, I want you to go public with your faith. I want you to take what's deeply personal and has been private. I want you to make it public. And so people took that step. They said, God, I'm in. See, we all make the choices. We all make the decision in life with those moments and with the movements of our lives is, are we in or are we out? What I loved about that moment at the Ryman is it was students who led the way. It was young people who set the room on fire. This is consistent with what I've learned in college football, because what I learned from watching college football is that the wave always starts in the student section. It's not the old people that start the wave. It's the student section that starts the wave, and the same is true in the kingdom of God, that when young people, like they're the young kindling that set the old logs on fire. And so when the students were captured by the love of God, it just changed the atmosphere, it changes the room. And that's why as a church, we're so passionate about the next generation. We're passionate about what God is doing in the lives of students and kids and college students across the city. It's why we're excited about bringing everybody together, all the generations together to worship together on Wednesday night. And we hope you can be here at the Nashville campus for our one church, for our night of worship together at 7 o'clock. But that's where it starts. It starts in the students. And what God is doing in the city among students is incredible. my 16-year-old daughter, Raleigh, she asked me, it was a few weeks back, maybe a month or so ago, she asked me, she said, Dad, she said, can I go to a rave? She's 16. I said, go to a what? And she said, a rave. I was like, do you know what they do at raves? And she said, yeah, but there's a group of us that are going to go, and we're going to go and pray for people and share the gospel. And I was like, the old pray for people, share the gospel trick. Yeah, I know. At the rave, that trick. But I asked more questions, and I found out, like, that was really what they were going to go do. And so that night, like, I'm tracking her on Life 360. I'm tracking her all through, like, downtown. She's with a group, and she came home, and she was so excited. She was like, Dad, we went down there, and this guy, Daniel and Luke, these two guys, they got up, and they prayed for people, and we prayed for people, and we shared the gospel, and there were people who came to Jesus there, and the promoter of the rave got saved. So listen, when the promoter of the rave comes to Jesus, there's a move of God going on. So there's a move of God going on in the city. The question is, are you in or are you out? Like, God is moving. Are you in or are you out? And it's a decision that we all make. God's moving. It's what we've been praying for is happening. And I'm going to tell you, there's a little bit of me, as we get to the end of Awaken, there's a little bit of me that's sad. Because I'm like, man, I don't want to sign off. I don't want to sign off on this move. A little bit, I mean, I'm not sad to eat. I'm excited about that. But like, I am sad in that I don't, as we've been praying and fasting, I don't want to miss out, because God's been doing so much. And I don't think it's in the heart of God to stop. I think God wants to continue. And so I don't want to sign off on this thing. And so our question is, God, what's the next? Like, how do you want to continue to wake people up? How do you want to continue to wake us up to who you are, God? How do you want to continue to move in our church? How do you want to continue to move in the city? And that's what I want to talk about today. But to get us into this part of the conversation, we just got to think about, if you're a parent, you know, when you wake your kids up, they have a choice to make. Am I in or am I out? They have a choice to make. Am I going to get up or am I going to stay in bed? They have a choice to make. Are they going to go along with you? And as the Father wakes us up, we have a choice to make too. Rhea and I had a crazy idea. It was maybe about longer than that. I think the kids were, how were they? 12, 10, 8, and 6. And we were sitting at Dunkin' Donuts, and we were eating some donuts, just Rhea and I, and we were having a conversation over chocolate donuts, because all the conversations go real good over donuts. And as we were talking, we looked down, and there were 4 more donuts, and we just had this idea of what would happen if we woke the kids up at 2 a.m. just to see if they wanted to eat a donut. We're weird. But, you know, we're like, I don't know where the idea came from, but we thought, let's do it. And so we took the 4 donuts home. And we woke him up at 2 a.m. and re-filmed filmed it. And we posted an Insta story back in the day about it. And I went and dug that up. Would you guys want to see it? All right, here's what happens. Check this out.
Hello again, everybody. Yes, we're here at Dunkin' Donuts. And there's going to be something special we want to tell you about these 4 donuts right here. Go ahead, Kev. Tell us.
All right, so here's what we're going to do. These 4 donuts are going to go to our kids at 2 o'clock in the morning. We're going to wake them up and feed them chocolate donuts. Just.
You want a donut? You want a donut?
Daddy.
Carol, you want a donut?
Daddy.
I got a donut, Carol. Here. It's good? Okay.
Okay. Oh. Good night.
Hey, you go. Hey, you go. Have donut. You can eat donut, Cam. Okay. Cam. Camden.
Here you go. Here's your donut. Here you go. You can just eat it. You don't have to wait.
Here you go. Bolt.
Oh, no.
Here's your donut. There you go.
I want to use a bear.
What? What'd you say?
So how long did it take us to go back to sleep?
Backfire.
How long?
An hour.
Yeah.
Now, that video puts us in 2 groups of people. How many of you feel sorry for our kids and you wonder if we're fit to be parents? How many of you, just by show of hands, That's one group of people. How many of you are thinking about going to pick up donuts on the way home and you're going to try it with your kids tonight? See, there are two groups of people, but it's biblical. What we do is biblical because the Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Like this. And so what I want you to see from that video is that the Father wants to wake us up, and he has good things, and that anytime he wants, this is a stretch, but anytime the Father wants to wake us up, it is for our good and it is for his glory. Like the Father wants to wake us up to his goodness, and God is waking people up, and he wants to know, are you in or are you out? And God's waking people up. And see, one thing I love is how many people I meet, how many conversations I get to have with people that God's just waking them up to more of him. How many people I get to talk to where this is the first time they've walked through the doors of the church. I was up in Hendersonville last week, and I met a man up in Hendersonville, and he was a big guy. He was about 6'4", and a Harley jacket, just big guy. His name is Kevin. And so when I met him, I mean, just yoked, just muscles. And when I met him, I was like, man, we got a lot in common. Same name. Same build, same height, man. I mean, this is just, yeah. He said, this is my first time here. I said, that's great, because Hendersonville's new campus. I'm thinking first time. He said, no, it's my first time to church. I'm like, ever? He's like, ever. I'm like, man, I'm so glad you're here. Like, when we say that everyone's welcome, it's like, man, we want this to be a place, whether it's your first time or your first time in a long time, where you can come in and you can seek out the things of God, where you can ask questions, where you can bring a spiritual curiosity, where you can discover more. And here's what God promises. He says, if you seek me, you will find me when you seek with all your heart. So keep seeking. Keep seeking after him. It says that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. And the greatest reward is himself. That we would know him. That we'd have a relationship with him. And so the Father is waking us up. And when he wakes us up, it's for our good and it's for his glory. And when Jesus walked the earth, he was waking people up to the love of God. He came to wake people up to the love of God. Jesus woke people up one at a time to God's love. He wanted to know, are you in? Are you in to receive the love of God? See, the religious system of Jesus' day had turned God's love into some kind of like transactional arrangement, in that if you were good enough, and if you kept the rules enough, and if you did all the right things, and if you held it all together, and if you looked the part, well then, maybe just then, God would love you too. And Jesus came to correct that theology. Jesus came to make sure that we know that God loves us first. And even before you ever do a thing, that God loves you. There's a story that's found. Jesus is waking people up with his signs, his wonders, his miracles. He wakes people up. He taught with an authority like nobody had ever had before. And Jesus teaches in a way to wake us up. And one time there's this miracle that gives us this teaching that I want to make sure that you see. And maybe see in a new way. There's a man who was a leper. And in the Old Testament, you see that there were laws about leprosy to help keep the disease from spreading. And if a person had leprosy, they were instructed, look in Leviticus, here was the law, that anyone with such a defiling disease must wear torn clothes, let their hair be unkept, cover the lower part of their face, and cry out, unclean, unclean. So the requirement was that if you had leprosy, I mean, it made the coronavirus look like a common cold, because it was a death sentence for everyone who ever got it. And it was called the death by inches, in that you would literally, your skin, your body would deteriorate and fall apart. And so if a person had leprosy, they had to stay 150 yards away from anybody else, and they would have to cover themselves and declare out unclean. Can you imagine living a life quarantined? Living the rest of your life quarantined from your family, from friends, from any relationships, from any physical touch, and you're covering your upper lip and you're declaring unclean, unclean. That was the death sentence of leprosy. And this leper comes to Jesus. In Matthew chapter 8, it says, when Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed him, and a man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. And Jesus reached out his hand and he touched the man. He said, I am willing. He said, be clean. And immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy. Now what I want you to see here is that Jesus reached out and he touched the man before he healed the man. You see this? See, all reason would say heal the man and then touch the man. Heal him and then touch him. But Jesus touched him first before he healed him. As if to say, I don't just love you when you're clean. I love you when you're unclean. As if to say, I don't just love you as you should be. I love you as you are right now. And that's the message that he gives to you. He's saying, you don't have to clean yourself up for me to love you. I love you as you are right now. So come to me as you are right now so that I can love you. Bring all of who you are to me. And then Jesus loves him and he cleanses him. You don't clean yourself up and come to Jesus. You come to Jesus and he cleans you up. He transforms your life with his love. And so you need to know. You need to know if it seems beyond reason that God could love you, his love is beyond reason. You can't rationalize it. You can't fathom it. It is unbelievable how much God loves you, but you better believe it. Jesus came to say, you can believe this. And he reaches out and touches him. And it's God's love. When we receive his love transforms us. His love changes us. And Jesus came to wake us up to the love of God, and he also came to wake us up to follow. He came to wake us up to follow. Jesus' invitation was not follow a list. Jesus' invitation was follow me. And so one of the first things that Jesus did when he started his ministry was he picked 12 disciples and he said, I want you to follow me. Now a disciple, rabbis in that day would have disciples. Disciples were Talmudim. They were the chosen students. Think apprentice. And so for a rabbi to call disciples, he would look, normally the rabbis would look for the ones that were like the best of the best. They were the cream of the crop. They were the ones that when a rabbi would pick disciples, he's going, I believe you can be like me. That I will train you and I will disciple you and I will let you be my apprentice because one day I believe that you can be like me. But when Jesus picked disciples, he didn't go to the Ivy League schools. He didn't go to Jerusalem University and look on the dean's list. He went to Nazareth Community College and looked for the 2.38 GPA. And he's like, he didn't pick the wealthy and he didn't pick the famous. He went and picked the obscure people. He picked fishermen. He picked the blue collar worker. Jesus picked ordinary people. And he's like, I believe you can be like me. And so if you ever feel like an underdog, if you ever feel like you're marginalized, if you ever feel like you don't measure up, Jesus goes, I believe you can be like me. Come be my disciple. His invitation to you today, he wants to wake up, is come follow me. That in a relationship with me, as you follow me, I will transform your life and I will make you more like me. And as you become more like Jesus, you become more who you were created to be. Jesus wants his character, his heart, his life through your personality. And that's when you light the world up. But that happens as we follow him. The invitation is to follow. See, he didn't pick the disciples because they were educated. He picked the disciples because they were teachable. I'm going to say it again. He didn't pick the disciples because they were educated. He picked the disciples because they were teachable. He picked 12 people who had hearts that yearned for God. He picked 12 people who wanted to learn. He picked 12 people who were willing to adjust their lives to what Jesus said. He picked 12 people who desired the kingdom of God more than anything. He picked those 12 people. See, being a sinner does not disqualify you from being a follower of Jesus. It's a prerequisite. It's a prerequisite. There is no sin that will keep you from being a follower of Jesus other than pride. Because humility is required to follow. And so the first thing that we have to do that pride keeps us from is say, I don't have it all together. I need help. I need a rescuer. I need a teacher. I need one to know who knows how to live this life. And Jesus said, come follow me. And so we humble ourselves and we follow. And to wake people up to follow, Jesus said some shocking things. He said in Matthew chapter 8, or Matthew chapter 8 is a great one too. But in Mark chapter 8, then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Now this is a shocking statement when Jesus says it. Because when he says take up their cross, like the cross wasn't a form of jewelry, it was a form of execution. And so when Jesus says, take up your cross, he's saying, you're going to have to die to self. If you want to be my disciple, if you want to be my Talmudim, if you want me to grow you into who you were made to be, if you want me to transform your life, you're going to have to deny yourself. You're going to have to die to self. You're going to have to give up your old life to receive your new life. You're going to have to let go of some things. You're going to have to deny yourself because I want to give you a life that's bigger than you. I mean, think about it. The biggest messes we've made in our lives, if you're anything like me, the biggest messes we've made in our lives is because we were focused on ourselves, because we were preoccupied with our ways, because we chose what we wanted rather than what was best. And Jesus said, deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me, and I'll give you a life worth living. I'll give you a life that's bigger than you. I smile whenever I walk past the self-help section of the bookstore. You know why? Because I need more help than self. It's self that gets me into this mess to begin with. I need a help that's bigger than self. And Jesus said, if you'll deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me, I'll give you life. Follow me. Follow me. He picks you. I was going through a time a few months back that was just, there was just a lot of stress, pressure. Those of you who are leaders, you know, sometimes there's just leadership pressure, leadership stress, and you add to that all the other complexities of life. And I was like, I need a pastor. I need somebody to sit down with. And I heard about a move of God that was going on in North Georgia where 10,000 people had been baptized. And I was like, I don't know what's going on there, but I sensed a nudge, like, go see what's happening there. And so I went to go meet with the pastor there, and the pastor, I said, hey, can we talk for a minute? I'd love for you to pray for me. And we're in this little back room, and he sat down across from me, and he said, tell me what's going on. I just communicated. I was telling about all just kind of the stress and the pressure. And he grabbed my hands. This older man just grabbed my hands, and he looked me in the eyes. You ever had somebody look in the eyes that it could be uncomfortable? Like, they're looking like, I mean, he was really looking at me in the eyes. So much so it got my attention. And then he said, Kevin, he said, he'd choose you. He said, if Jesus was walking through Dalton, Georgia right now, or through Dawsonville, Georgia, he's walking through Dawsonville, Georgia right now, and he was choosing disciples, he'd pick you. And I knew that theologically. I knew that God loves everyone. I knew that it's not his desire that any would perish, but that all would repent, that all would turn to him. And I know that God doesn't play favorites. So I know it theologically that God would choose me, but in that moment, my heart encountered it experientially. And you need to know that the God of all creation looks at you, that Jesus looks at you and he says, I pick you. Come follow me. The line following Jesus is one deep. He said, I want you to follow. And he said things like that so that it would wake us up to realize that the life that he dreams for us and really the life that we dream for comes through following. Take up your cross and follow me. And Jesus came to wake us up to a life on mission. Jesus came to give us a mission that's bigger than us. He came to commission us with a mission that is bigger than our little lives. He came to wake us up to his love. He came to wake us up to follow, and he came to wake us up to a mission. In Luke chapter 10, we began this series with Luke chapter 10, where Jesus gives the story of the Good Samaritan. And before that story, he gives us this truth. He said that if you want to experience eternal life, if you want to experience true life, if you want to experience the life of God, you got to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. And that's where we began this series. Because it's through loving God that then we open ourselves up to receive his love. And it's only when we're loved by God that we can love our neighbor as we love ourselves, because it's only when we receive God's love that we're able to love ourselves. And it's only when we first are able to love ourselves that we can truly love our neighbors. And so it begins with a love for God, and then it goes into the neighborhood. And what I've loved over these 30 days is I've been praying for my neighbors. If you've been praying for your neighbors, you look around, you just see them differently. You just realize how easy it is to crop this life down because of busyness, because of career, because of errands, because of family, because of all the pressures and the things. It's easy to crop this life down and crop out our neighbors and their needs and their lives and all that's going on around us. It's easy to crop out a life on mission. It's easy to whittle things down to a mission that's just about self. And God wants to wake us up. Wake us up to a life on mission. And so what Jesus does in this passage, earlier in the passage, Luke chapter 10, he sends the disciples out on a mission. And after this, the Lord appointed 72 others, and he sent them out two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. And he told them, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. So Jesus pulls the 12 together. He's like, all right, let's get some more. He gets 72. He calls 72 together, and he says, I'm forming a ministry team. I'm going to get this team together, and I'm going to send you out. And so I want you to imagine that you're having a conversation with Jesus, that Jesus approaches you about being on his ministry team, that Jesus sends you a text. Imagine getting this text. Welcome to the ministry group. You respond back. New phone, who dis? He responds back. Oh, right, it's Jesus. You respond back. Yes, here for this. Because if you're talking to Jesus, you better put the prayer emoji. Like, it's just going to go in there. But just imagine that Jesus sends you a text. He's like, I want you to be in my ministry. Imagine that you get invited to be a part of the 72. It may be hard for you to imagine being a part of the 12. We'll get there. But right now, just imagine he's looking at you and saying, I want you to be a part of the 72. That's what he's saying to me. That's what he's saying to you. I want you to be a part of this ministry group. Why 72? Well, many scholars believe that in that day that there were 72 known nations in the world. And so in other words, Jesus is saying, hey, we're taking this to the world. I have a heart for the nations. And so he gathers those 72 in. He's like, okay, here's what we're going to do. First thing we're going to do before we go, before we break this huddle, we're going to pray. We're going to pray because the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. So we're going to pray that God would send workers. Now, why would Jesus say, pray first? Why would Jesus say, let's pray before we go? We look at it and say, let's go and ask God to bless what we do. Jesus said, pray first for workers. Why? Because the greatest danger of a movement is that a movement turns inward. The greatest danger in a movement is the movement becomes about itself and implodes. That we start thinking about our needs and what we want and what we, Jesus said, no, you got to focus on the harvest. Be focused on the outside. Be focused on those that don't know yet. Don't just focus on it. Be focused on ourselves. He said, and pray for more workers. Why would he say pray for more workers? Because it's going to take more than 72. It's going to take more than 12. It's going to take more than us. And here's the danger. Is that once we get in on the movement, we can start thinking about me. I can think about my parking space and my seat and my songs and my service and my small group and my experience, and it can turn inward when we start focus on us. But if we pray for workers, if we pray for the harvest, it turns our hearts outward. And oftentimes, God will set us praying for something that he wants us to be the answer to. You tracking with that? See, we started praying for CrossPoint to find a pastor before God called us to move to Nashville. Before God called me to be the pastor, to lead pastor at CrossPoint, he first put it in my heart to pray that CrossPoint, I didn't know that it would be me. I was just praying, God, would you bring a pastor to CrossPoint? He's like, yeah. Hey, don't be surprised when you've been praying for your neighbors, when the Spirit of God taps your shoulder to say, I want you to be the answer to your prayers. God will use us to be answers to the prayers, but he uses prayer to shift our heart to his agenda. And so Jesus gathers them together, and look at what he says. He says, I'm sending you out. Go, I'm sending you out like lambs among wolves. I want you to go. I'm sending you out like lambs among wolves. He's waking them up to this mission. Wolves, I'm waking up this mission. It's like sending your 16-year-old daughter to a rave. He's like, I got to tell you some things first. And then he gives them this instruction. He said, first off, I want you to go in twos. In other words, get your friend, get your buddy. I want you to go. I want you to go in twos. He makes 36 teams. And you can read the chapter later on, Luke chapter 10, you'll see it. And then he says, I want you to travel light. In other words, I don't want you to go burdened down. I just want you to put the things, I want you to take like one change of clothes. And I don't want you to burden yourself down with, he says, don't take a whole lot of money. In other words, I want you to see how God's your provider when you live a life on mission. So I don't want you to carry things that would burden. Some of us, the reason that we're not living on mission is because we're holding on to things from our past that God's saying, I want you to let go of so I can help you live life on mission. So I want you to travel light. And then he says, I'm sending you out like sheep among wolves. What he means there is he's saying, I want you to be careful because there are people who want to destroy you. There's an enemy that wants to destroy you. There's things that would be distraction. I want you to be aware of what's going on around you. He says, go to the neighborhoods, go to the villages, go to the towns, and I want you to do two things. I want you to heal the sick, and I want you to tell them that the kingdom of God is near. Now, we get intimidated by that because we're like, well, I don't know how to heal the sick. God does. Jesus is saying, I just want you to do what I did. I want you to go, and I want you to be with people, even in their hurt, even in their mess, even in their sickness, even in the chaos of their lives. I want you to go and be with them. And then I'll do the healing. I'll do the work. Pray for them, and then I'll do the work. And he says, and I want you to tell them the kingdom of God is here. In other words, tell them that God loves them too. And who knows how much healing that would bring to their heart to know that truth. But they can't know that truth. They can't be awakened to that truth unless we carry it to them. And so Jesus sends out the 72, and he's saying, are you in or are you out? And they say, we're in. And look what happens. They come back. And it says, the 72 returned with joy. And they said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. They're like, we're seeing stuff we've never seen before. That darkness was broken, that people were set free, that lives were changed, salvation happened. We saw people, their forever was changed. We saw people who were healed. Jesus, and they're popping champagne in the locker room. They're like, this is incredible. And look at what Jesus said to them. He said, however, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Jesus is saying, Don't just rejoice in ministry results, because ministry results can be fickle. Don't just rejoice in things that can change, because sometimes you don't see the healing right there. Sometimes you don't see the neighbor's life change. Sometimes you don't see people show up for the small group. Sometimes people will turn their back on you. Sometimes people will reject you. So don't rejoice in what can change. Rejoice in what can never change, and that's that your name is written in the book. Let your primary rejoicing in life be in the thing that never changes, and that is that you are secure in the love of God and that your eternity is secure in him. So Jesus said, rejoice in that. He said, rejoice in the fact that your name is written in the book. Rejoice that God saved you. Stay awake to the love of God. And then Jesus said this. At that time, Jesus, full of joy through the Holy Spirit, said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. This phrase right here, full of joy, it's the only time we see this in the New Testament. This means like he had the thrill of joy. I want you to imagine Coach Vrabel after the Titans beat the Patriots. Like that's Jesus' disposition in this moment. Like he is full of joy. He is thrilled with joy. He is celebrating. Here's what we learn here is that it delights the heart of God when we serve him. It delights the heart of God when we say, God, I'll do whatever, whenever, however. God, you can use my life to bring healing to other people, and you can use my life so that other people experience your love. It brings joy to the heart of God when we say, God, I'm in. With what you're doing around me, God, I'm in. I'm in. God's moving, and he's going to continue to move. His move is not limited to 30 days. There's more that he wants to do. And sometimes we wait on a move of God, but sometimes God waits on us to move. And as he waits on us to move, the question is, I'm moving. Are you in or are you out? We've been praying for 30 days, and I wonder if God doesn't just look at us and go, I'm waking you up to my love, and I'm waking you up to follow me, and I'm waking you up to a life on mission. Are you ready to be the answer to your prayers? Are you ready to be the answer to somebody else's prayers? Will you follow? And so we want to pray and let today, instead of today being a signing off, that today would be a sending out. Instead of today being a signing off to 30 days, that it would be a sending out to the more that God wants to do in waking up the city and waking up your neighborhood. And so I wanna pray, and with a song, let this song be a prayer. Because it's our prayer as we say, God, thank you for what you've done. Thank you for how when God awakens people, when God sends revival, he does it one person at a time. And so we say, God, thank you for the baptisms, for what you did this past week. But God, we're asking for more. That you would wake us up, and that you would wake up the city, our communities, our neighborhoods even more. Let's pray together. Would you bow your heads with me? Father, there's just a sense today that you're issuing an all call. that you're issuing an all call and you're calling us to more. I pray for those today who have never received your love. They've been running, searching. God, I pray that today would be a surrender to your love. If you've never received the love of God, then you just begin by saying, God, would you help me surrender to your love? Would you help me receive your love? Would you help me love you? God, I pray for those today who have never made the decision to follow. Maybe today is a day of demarcation. Maybe you're somebody that other people have been praying for. God's already moving in your heart. But today is a waking up to that invitation to follow. Maybe you've been a fan of Jesus. Maybe you've been observing. Maybe you've been keeping your distance. But today is the day where you begin to follow Jesus. And you can just begin that with a prayer saying, Jesus, just whisper this to him. Jesus, today I begin to follow you. I want to give you my life. I want to take up my cross, deny myself, and follow you. You just sense the Father's pleasure with that. That's what Jesus gave his life for. And then, God, I pray for all of us that we'd live a life on mission, where we've whittled this thing down and made it about us, or we repent. We repent from making life about us. We turn to you. We welcome your invitation to be a part of your 72. Thank you that 72 fully committed to you on mission can change the world. And as much faith and as trust as you've given, God, would you give us the faith and the courage today to say, God, we'll be in on your ministry team, your 72, send us out. God, I pray that right now you'd awaken a burden and a passion for a people, for a place, for a corner of the city. A passion that would drive us to be obedient and do whatever you ask, whenever you ask it. That we would see lives change, that we would see healing take place, that we'd see people experience the power and the presence, the rule and reign of your kingdom. That we would see heaven up there come down here. That we would see revival. And God, that we would celebrate that it happens one at a time. In Jesus' name, amen.